basis for secondary academic funding, how governments, charities, writers, and spend their money. This issue matters a great deal. Over 4,000 Americans have been killed in Iraq and Afghanistan, 1,000 more are coming from debilitated physical and psychological injuries. Our country owes these heroes honor and genuine gratitude. If these soldiers and their families face crippling financial burdens as a result of their service, we owe them generous help there too. Our December hearing showed that countless Americans are already willing to help. They are selflessly donating hundreds of millions of dollars to charities that purport to help veterans. They are trying to help those who gave such tremendous sacrifice for us all. Many of the charities are doing invaluable work and spend most of the dollars they receive directly on veterans. Other organizations, however, engage what I think is an intolerable fraud. Most of the millions they receive never reach veterans or their families. Instead, the groups waste those contributions on bloated overhead costs and self-enrichment. We were privileged in the December hearing to receive testimony from Ed Edwards, the father of a soldier who was seriously wounded in Iraq. He told us about the great challenges families like his face as they try to get their loved ones the care they deserve. And he told us this: "My son, as well as the other thousands of injured soldiers from this war or any other war, they are not a commodity. Organizations come to us to offer assistance. We gladly welcome them to aid in our quest. But I don't think it's right that you can use these soldiers as commodities to raise funds and as an organization to say that you're raising funds to aid all of the thousands of soldiers and then turn around and give a small percentage of that to what you're saying that you're going to do with the contribution." Mr. Edmondson's concern is why we held our first hearing and why we are holding our hearing today. Although we have invited Roger Chapin, who is operating a number of governments and military charities over the past 40 years, to join us in December, he refused to attend voluntarily, and he evaded service of a subpoena by federal marshals. I'm glad Mr. Chapin reconsidered his position for this hearing. This charity has raised over $168 million from 2004 to 2006, but our analysis reveals that only 25% of that money was spent on veterans. During those 3 years, Mr. Chapin and his wife received over $1.5 million in compensation from these groups and received hundreds of thousands of dollars more in reimbursements. My staff prepared a memorandum that provided analysis of the funds received by Mr. Chapin's charities and how they were used. And without objection, that memorandum and the documents themselves would be made part of the hearing record. Mr. Chapin believes there is another side to this story, so it is important that we have an opportunity to share his perspective with us. I look forward to his testimony and the testimony of all of our witnesses on this very important issue. Our actions, not our words, are the true measure of our commitment to our veterans. And this committee will continue to try to honor their service through fair and thorough oversight. My colleague and friend Tom Daniels has done exactly that, and I want to recognize you for this.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members of the committee, I understand the great need to our nation through the veterans. Before the first day of counts, the pain and the suffering endured by hundreds of individual service members and their families, too often trapped in government, bureaucracy, mired in destroying welfare processes in the nation. We've seen a stubborn failure to acknowledge and effectively treat traumatic brain injuries and post-traumatic stress disorder. We've been overreading that America's heroes and their families trying to heal and heal. For many veterans, an important part of their journey may have involved critical work provided by charities. These charities are supported by millions of generous, patriotic Americans. So this committee is effort to assess the reach and effectiveness of veterans' charities as a legitimate timely exercise of our oversight responsibilities. While it's not solid law that charitable solicitations make resources for children with advisors. When I first joined in December, we heard about family services and charities and discussed some of the standards developed by private watchdogs and others to assess charitable operations and help donors make informed choices about how to best serve veterans. At that time, I said there is no percentage of magic ratio of program expenditures to fundraising costs that are adequate to set reasons good charities for veterans. Other factors have to be considered: transparency, governance, traffic. But we have to be concerned about complex business models and business practices that consistently direct as much of the money raised in the service and capital work on veterans as veterans. Our mentors are likely to be fired and parking behind the First Amendment, tax shield, sharp practices, and never be from the responsible public scrutiny. Sooner or later, donors will see through the fire and direct their voting in the best of realities and exploit exploitative self-serving charities. We just want to make sure we're going to contribute have the tools to do so. Today's panel is specifically the national governments and charities operated by Mr. Roger Chapin. His biggest charity, Hospitalized Vets, has been praised by some, criticized by others. This is the focus of the series for all of us in Forbes magazine. The question whether fund transfers across the network of veterans' charities and advocacy arms will be used to disguise on salaries, military expenses, and other fiscal trickery. After some initial difficulties in scheduling this panel, Mr. Chapin has agreed to testify as provided substantial documentation in response to the committee's request. We appreciate his cooperation and hope to learn more detail as he runs his veterans' charities. Testimony by both now voters and others will also help us understand the operating realities and the benefits of this sustained and important segment of our national support systems for veterans. Without questions, veterans' charities, including Mr. Chapin's, have provided help and inestimable value to women and American heroes. Now we ask him and others to help us ensure that he's taken advantage of the generosity of Americans who also care deeply about their nation. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Davis. I'd like to thank the members of the chance to make an opening statement before the end of the day. If I may ask my witnesses, so I just say thank you very much, Mr. Davis. 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 Thank you very much, something to try to figure out
effectiveness in providing services and use donations efficiently. This committee is learning this is not always the case. At our first hearing on Veterans Charities, it was disconcerting given the amount of donations that were recycled in the fundraising cost versus used to provide services to veterans these charities were claiming to help. This practice does a great disservice to Americans who think their pennies and dollars are providing aid and comfort to our nation's veterans. It is appalling to these veterans as poster children to keep crying on charities and business while planning to provide substantial services to this large and needy population. If charities are failing or are not providing proper assistance, then it is our work to identify and make transparent to the public those charities who are not reputable. Today we will hear Mr. Roger Chapin, whose Veterans Charities have been negatively rated by some charity watchdog groups, and whose practices have been the subject of negative investigation reports in Forbes magazine. But Mr. Chapin's Veterans Charities have collected millions of millions of dollars over the years, the vast majority of which are not ancient veterans or their families. That fact alone merits his appearance before this committee. The U.S. Supreme Court's district of the economy stands in the federal government to require charities to divulge fundraising costs to donors or to limit the percentage charities may spend on fundraising. The court noted that for many charities, the process of raising money is often bitter time without fee and education, so fundraising should be considered a form of free speech protected by the First Amendment, Some causes are hard to raise money for, but groups like Veterans Council and Firemen are the subject of the most instances of charity fraud and broad solicitation because it is easy to exploit feelings of patriotism and community to solicit money for those hard to say no to heroes. I question the content of some of direct mail appeals and the costs associated with direct mailings. I question the privacies and allusions to programs made by charities in direct mail solicitations and language that is purposely confusing. I question the use of sweepstakes and free crickets as a proper use of donations to secure more donations. I question repeated mailings directed to our seniors on limited incomes exploiting their patriotism and generosity. I question the reasoning behind the number of mailings sent to the same people month after month after month. I look forward to hearing from Mr. Roger Lieberman and Mr. Jeffrey Peters, whose direct mail companies have contracts with Mr. Chapin's charities. It is important to understand the nature of the direct mail business, what contracts contain with Brian's mail contract, and why fundraising costs are so high. I have specific questions about the management practices of the Chapin Veterans Charities, Health Hospitals, Veterans, the Coalition, SOAR, American Heroes Foundation, and Health Wounded Heroes. In the Internal Revenue Service 990 forms and Board of Director minutes from these charities indicate that over the years, Mr. Chapin and his wife have received millions of dollars in salary supplement at their large, expensive grants. I question the merit of Mr. Chapin's wife's salary and lack of adequate documentation for expenses paid by the donors in the name of veterans. I question the movement of funds and loans between these charities. It disguises real fundraising costs in an effort to achieve higher ratings by charity watchdog groups, ultimately deceiving donors. I look forward to working with my colleagues in this committee on a bipartisan basis and in the Congress to see what might be done to stop waste and use and fraud by charities so that Americans will continue to give with the confidence their donations actually make the difference. Mr. Chairman, again, I was very happy to thank you for having us here.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for this question. So much, Mr. Chairman, as you saw, my own point for the office is also critical.
Mr. Chairman, Americans have given millions of dollars to help thousands of veterans wounded in Iraq and Afghanistan. Americans are known as a giving people who will open up their hearts and wallets for just causes. It is, therefore, all the more discerning when we learn that some of the traffic groups relatively little money on the wounded while collecting millions. According to an article in last December's Washington Post, the American Institute of Philanthropy reported present his testimony today, and I'm very pleased that Mr. Chapin has come forward. Mr. Chapin is the president of Young Hospitalized Veterans. We understand he received $426,000 in salary and benefits, and your wife received an additional $113,000. Mr. Chairman, I don't want to make light of anyone earning a livable wage. Not profiting from their endeavors, but profiting from excess on the backs of those who are in need does not strike me as very American, or at least the way Americans view themselves. Such practices do not benefit veterans, veterans organizations, nor the public at large, and don't speak well of us as a society. So I look forward to your testimony, Mr. Chapin, that what I have read about these charities appears to me to represent a pattern of decades of abuse, maybe not in law, but in the spirit. Thank you again, Mr. Chairman. Yes, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, thank you for holding this down. As you said, you don't count it as ground settled with that. When it comes down to veterans and active duty military, and this issue was obviously a very important issue in the community of San Diego. The fact is that Mr. Chapin served for 6 years as one of my constituents in my previous state in Congress. And though I have no personal knowledge of his involvement with veterans or organizations of any kind, I did have the opportunity to work professionally with him on an issue that I made you address strongly on, Mr. Chapin, and that was to perpetuate a national program of health prevention. And because of my previous personal relationship with Mr. Chapin, I will not be asking him any questions today. Appreciate the fact that this hearing being held and that we get these issues out. And I know that Mr. Chairman, I want to thank the chairman and the ranking member for that persistence in investigating these questionable fundraising practices, especially given the fact that Mr. Chapin resisted the first subpoena. I think that it is disgraceful that anyone might capitalize on the goodwill and the support of the American people to support a man and woman in uniform for their own personal benefit. As have many of the members of this committee, I just got back from my second trip to Iraq. See the sacrifice of men and women in uniform. Looks like one of the abuses happened into working me in and out of the hospital quite a few times to be our soldiers. It is disgraceful that anyone would capitalize on those circumstances. And the dignity of the American people to rally behind our troops. I think it's a disservice to the memory of those who have made the ultimate sacrifice on behalf of our country, both in Iraq and Afghanistan. I think it's a disservice to those brave Americans who continue their brave service. I think it's a disservice as well. And most dangerously, to the legitimate veterans support organizations that are out there who are legitimate, who are operating transparently. Who are trying to do the very best on behalf of our veterans, because I fear that when the facts of these irregularities come out and the circumstances that we're investigating today, that Americans might grow hesitant or reluctant to support certain charities, even though their programs are up to snuff and are legitimate and are intended and used for the best interests of veterans and their families. So, Mr. Chairman, just Chapin resisted the last subpoena. I'm eager to hear his testimony, as I said. Maybe he saw the story and he'll
thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
just those organizations and the people who are involved in raising the money. And I guess having that confidence is very important. We want to know that people to continue to give and support our veterans, and they need to have a confidence that we're going to make that contribution, and that is in fact part of the people that they want to support, not the veterans. And of course, out of that, we want to support the veterans because the whole purpose of making those contributions is to help those who are entitled to help. And I do think that we need to do a lot more to protect the public that wants to give, and at the same time protect our veterans within the process and make sure that they get the benefit of what the American people want to give them. So I really hope that both in terms of the education process that these units provide, but also if we can look at other measures that we might take to make sure that people have to fully disclose how much of what they're raised goes to the veterans. And that way, it's going to be simply to finance the operations of the nonprofit and to benefit those who run the nonprofit and some of the veterans. So, if you've got the people to make sound choices about how best to help our veterans, that's what everyone's on. So, thank you all for your leadership. Thank you very much, Mr. Bell, and Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd just like to reinforce the comments that have been made concerning resolve to make sure that veterans pay the respect that they deserve, and they are not exploited out there. The private sector running businesses like that can build a lot of legitimate nonprofit organizations, and some clearly operate as public services, and some clearly operate as businesses. And unfortunately, we've seen too many instances here where organizations look around like businesses and using our veterans as basically a raw material to work into. And I think that's what we're concerned about, covering it correctly if that's the problem. So I thank you for this hearing and I look forward to the testimony of witnesses.
Mr. Chairman, I'm a little anxious about whether there needs to be a strict regulation of charities to see how they spend their money. I can say this, I think that any charity has a duty of obligation. They have a trust that's being placed in them, and they don't really know when they make a pitch. But it says the charities that serve our veterans have an extra obligation, because there is a deeper trust placed on them, and a broader trust with respect to disability and other charitable endeavors. So the standard expectation is that they're aware of this meeting, and I'm also going to thank you for this meeting. I look forward to hearing this testimony and asking the questions that need to be asked. Thank you very much, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be very brief. It's an administrative matter that I hope to do in the spirit of doing better in the future. Mr. Chairman, there's a developing pattern that I object to, that we think we're ready for a hearing, but in fact, rather than 3 days before the hearing, receiving the scope and the intention, which obviously the people here testified today have to be equally informed of why we brought the hearing, what we expect. Members of the case meeting. And so once again, we received a draft supplement last night, and to this moment, have not, even though it's in the record, have not received our official copy of that statement. So it's an administrative matter. I realize that it is, although your leadership is critical, that it is a staff matter, that in the future, I will have to object if we don't have legitimate statements, from the majority 3 days before the hearing. Otherwise, I would have to ask at least the attempt to postpone hearings until we have that. And I would hope that is the right time to say for future hearings, because I want these hearings like this one, which is very bipartisan, to be about getting to the meat of it in 3 days, and then I would have to ask for to make sure our staff is prepared as much as our
Thank you.
I appreciate that.
we're going to do the result of the night. I'm trying to make sure that we're going to do it. And in order to get to our panel, I just want to add one thing. Between the first go round of this, in which I spoke, like many of us here today, it's very strongly as a veteran about how bad it is that you were using people who have been injured in their service to our country as a way to often line the pockets of individuals who have no interest in that. I would hope that people would conclude this, that we also expand this. Because ever since the first hearing, my office has been widely informed by other abuses, and being abuses very similar to the government's ones, dealing with homeless, dealing with food banks, and dealing with environmental groups. And so I would hope that, that we use this as a springboard for a broader reform of a whole charitable giving versus the line of the pockets of homeless and solicit. And I know that's a bipartisan effort that we can't do, and I would once again hope that we would do it. I look forward to completing this cycle, though, because we need to get to the bottom of it and find real solutions so that our government is not prey to permanent relief. The fundraising is not prey to permanent relief, so we don't feel bad. Thanks for having us here. We have before us Roger Chapin from San Diego, California, who operates several different veterans charitable organizations. Richard Vicker is president of American Target Advertising, and director of business located in Manassas, Virginia. Jeffrey W. Peters is president of Community Direct Response, a direct mail business located in Bowie, Maryland. And Linda J. Jones, senior assistant attorney general for the state of California. That's the charitable trust section of the California Attorney General's Office. We're pleased to welcome each of you to this hearing today. Your prepared statements will be made for the record in its entirety. What I'd like to ask each of you to do, because it is the practice of this committee of all witnesses to testify under oath, is if you would please bow your eyes and raise your right hand. So I will swear that the testimony you will give before the committee will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. The record will indicate that each of the witnesses answered in the affirmative. As I indicated, the statements will be in record in full that you've submitted to us for an oral presentation. And we have a limit, the presentation, to 5 minutes. We will have a timer. We will be green during that 5 minute period. Mr. Chapin, there's a book on the basis of the mind that you thought you could come to carry on, and I would like to invite you to that first.
Mr. Chairman, Representative Davis, members of the committee, on November 26th, the committee sends a letter requesting the Department of Production of thousands of documents. Inviting me to testify in the hearing 16 days later, on December 13th, I was considered with our firm earlier to come to conference in early December on this firing event, where we invited civilian wounded heroes and foreign carriers and families who are busy running at our expense. Because of the conference, because my wife was recovering from back surgery, because we moved out of our home for scheduled renovations, and because I did not have time to prepare, I declined the committee's invitation to appear. I bring a personal letter of apology to Mr. Weiss and Mr. Davis for the inconvenience I caused the committee. I've done what I can to make it clear that so long as I have adequate time to prepare, I have no problem cooperating with the committee. The voluntary appearance of the transcribed interview with the committee staff that took all day Friday. I am proud to report these unhospitalized veterans in HHV, which I found in 1971. He generated $470 million in donations and distributed $362 million worth of products and services based on their market value. This represents 77% of total donations, both positive and HHV does right by its donors, as well as hospitalized vets. HHV has distributed 23 million craft kits and millions of greeting cards signed by donors on the list of our hospitalized donors. Charity Navigator, for leading internet charity rating shows, paid HHV $2, the same as numerous well-respected charities, including the American Cancer Society, American Diabetes Association, National Wildlife Federation, the Boy Scouts, the YMCA, VFW, and Paralyzed Veterans America, Special Olympics, and the Young Heart Start. You might say HHV is a very good cause. company. The coalition of some American shareholders distributed over $3,500 Christmas gift checks to feed disabled one-on-one veterans and their families, in addition to helping over 6,000 families with direct emergency care assistance, plus the over 1,200 disabled vets and their family members who have life-changing four-day or expense paid COVID recovery conferences in Disney World, providing 6 million plus free loans to fast coffee to disabled vets, assisting hundreds in finding jobs, furnishing counseling, and many more, and picking up travel expenses and rent to families visiting their living loved ones in military hospitals. The bottom line of direct mail is that if you disregard allocations for education and programmatic content, direct mail generally nets us approximately 35 cents on the dollar, and administration costs generally average around 10%. That is true for my charities, and it is true for the thousands of charities in the United States that pay $60 billion annually by direct mail, over most other charities that hire direct mail costs in reading. Same numbers apply to political fundraising by direct mail, and most of those state charities in the United States are made in arms. In the same language, it's you. Throughout my life, I have endeavored to do well for my family and other charities that have done this work. I've been working for HHV for 21 years, paying for as a volunteer. Before HHV, the board paid me more than $74,000 a year. In 1993, the first year I made over $100,000 in salary, I was 60 years old, and I had no retirement plan. I'm grateful for the HHV's board voted for a retirement plan in 1998, and I've been reading on full-time employees. Because I was 66 when the plan began, HHV had to make very high contributions to fund my retirement. I'm grateful for the board's generosity, but it's still making less than the average of nonprofit executives of similar size organizations. Before closing, I have one request. I would hope that we could work together and help me to ensure that Congress finally fulfills its solemn obligation for over 300,000 veterans or more out there who are afflicted with PTSD and or TBI. When Canada's own admission, government hospitals are woefully ill-equipped to treat them, and the vast majority are still denied the opportunity to seek necessary therapy in the private sector at government expense. I consider this to be a national scandal of the worst sort. I know, Mr. Chairman, you and the Canadian Health Care Act designed focused attention on this problem, but Congress still has not appropriated the funds necessary to provide the necessary care. Thank you, and for a full and fair opportunity.
Mr. Cummings, unlike most people, I don't like you for the first time. You look perfect. Thank you. Could you rub the hell back as I have for the closing? I thought it was you.
Chairman Hodgson, Ranking Member Davis, and members of the committee, I am here today to have so called invitation. I must say, it's the first invitation I've ever received from members of Congress that wasn't for one of my fundraising events. In 1960, just 5 years before I started my marketing agency, I estimate there were only about $60,000 to the charity mix and payment for campaigns. Americans received their news and information from very limited sources, with controlled, filtered, and limited what Americans knew about what really happens in Washington. Applying commercial marketing principles to closed-minded fundraising, it pioneered direct mail for political and ideological causes. The FDA's Let Sons magazine charge this is one of the defining political moments of the 20th century. I've found ways to communicate with, involve, and raise money from millions of everyday citizens supporters rather than a few traditional fucked up numbers. Today, the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee, chaired by Congressman Bill Mellon of this committee, markets its list of 282,000 names. So he has a beneficiary of what I pioneered. I estimate over 8 million people will make a contribution to this presidential election cycle to some campaign. The founding fathers added the First Amendment to our Constitution because it is inevitable that political elites will seek to silence their critics and competitors in the marketplace of ideas. This year, we have won two of the tips. Four times in the past 27 years, the United States Supreme Court has ruled that charitable fundraising with high cost is fully protected by the First Amendment. It is not fraud. However, Mr. Chairman, in the December 13th hearing on Veterans Charities, we defamed certain charities for their high fundraising costs by calling them fraud. That hearing is based on the false premise that the sole purpose of a charitable solicitation is to raise money. Charities advertising pages do far more than just soliciting donor money. I remember Earl
bands that come up on our network, they receive background very differently than the kind of bands that are unpopular in the network. Rather than providing enough federal funds for our veterans, two main members of Congress have spent millions on earmarks and big projects in their districts. That abuse of congressional power is a major reason why veterans and their families are going to be short of the state. But that's not the only abuse of power we can discuss today. Today is just the beginning of a very important national hearing about issues of Congress that do on the slippery road. It is a debate about hypocrisy, legal fraud, and quid pro quo money laundering of power, what you will, and political fundraising conducted by members of Congress. Americans are angry because of the abuse of power by Congress and other agents in Washington. Their ratings are at their lowest level because now more than ever, American citizens have access to information from the new and alternative news about the political line of Washington. Some of the most effective and most outspoken critics of Congress are charities and other nonprofit organizations. Many of the landmark First Amendment cases, such as the NAACP versus Alabama, the New York Times versus Sullivan, involve attempts by the government to intimidate and silence nonprofits because they are such effective critics of government. This committee is investigating charities that have received bad grants from one individual whose methods are not accepted by other charity rating systems, nor the standards of the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants. Also, surprisingly, even shocking, he does not grade or evaluate the effectiveness of a charity. Members of Congress aren't required by law to hire independent certified public accountants and file detailed reports about their own cost of fundraising and your American Institute of Certified Public Accountants rules, but charities must. Your contract with fundraisers aren't regulated by state attorney generals, but charities are. Nor are your contracts on file for public inspection, but the contracts for charities are. Charities can strong-arm lobbyists and corporate pays for contributions in exchange for access, influence, and legislative favors. In other words, the playing field is not level. And I say, level the playing field. Whatever charities must do to report and comply with the law, members of Congress should do the same. Mr. Chairman, over the past 10 years, your personal campaign committee has raised money extensively for your own re-election. Yet you have passed through almost exactly 50% to other political candidates and committees. 50% over 10 years looks less like a campaign committee than money laundering enterprise. You also formed this thing called LA Debt to solicit gasoline even more money. You give that money to candidates with whom your donors may disagree on issues important to the donors. You carry it to the donors without even any contribution. That sounds like what is called bait and switch in commercial politics. Any way you look at it, it appears wrong and unseemly. There are a host of rotten issues in congressional fundraising. Yet this committee recommended killing First Amendment rights of nonprofit and other citizen-backed organizations with attempt on censorship and direct confidential with the United States Supreme Court and state government. There are plenty of outstanding and very influential charities with high fundraising costs. Mr. Chairman, your agenda here is political. Anti-competitive, unconstitutional, if I may be frank, mean. You've got cheap headlines and expensive affirmations from very worthy charities. Their cause wrong for their unconstitutional purpose. Limited amount of information that the public receives. Mr. Vickerman, your time has expired. What you have said and what you are trying to do has and will continue to result in harm to my health for veterans. As part of that process, you are abusing the powers of this institution. Shame on you, Mr. Chairman, and shame on any member of this committee who has participated in such an agenda.
Mr. Williams contacted me only to find that it's a question at one point the microphone on the question. When Mr. Williams contacted me, invited me to testify on the House for information I could provide that would make use to the committee, Mr. Williams indicated perhaps information concerning cost of fundraising. A number of you have asked about that. Mr. Sarbanes and Streisand, in particular, have mentioned that they're concerned about the possibility for how regulation might be formulated. Let me start by giving you a hypothetical. Which charity deserves our support? The one that raises $100,000, spends 90% of it feeding the poor, has 10% administration costs and lower annual fundraising costs, and feeds 90 people. Or the one that raises $100,000, spends 25%.
second channel is more effective than the first. Yet it has a higher cost of fundraising ratio. Cost of fundraising ratio has been looked at with our industry for decades. Scholars have looked at it, people within the industry have looked at it, state regulators have focused upon it, and we've had four Supreme Court decisions on it. One of the things that I can tell you from the literature is that cost of fundraising ratios as a measure of the effectiveness or as a measure of the efficiency of the charity have been widely debunked by nearly everybody in the industry. Let me give you an example. What is against drug driving is a charity that sends out millions of direct mail letters every year. Every year, those direct mail letters include an appeal for funds. Yet, they took that joint cost allocated. And contrary to what Mr. Shays implied, having been shuffling money, that joint cost allocation under the accounting rules that the charities required to abide by, they allocated in part to public education and in part to fundraising. Does that make sense? Well, if you ask the people from what is against drug driving, which reporters have done and regulators have done, their response is those letters save lives. They remind people in their daily life at home when they're sitting down at dinner with their teenagers, don't drink and drive. So how should we account for that? If we don't account for that as part of their mission fulfillment, how do we? And will that charity that uses those letters that way end up receiving a poor rating from Mr. Borkoff at AIP because he doesn't allow for joint cost allocation in his rating system? There's lots of you mentioned that you will rely on Mr. Borkoff's study when you read the Washington Post article. Let me ask you, what do you think of Harvard University? One of our great educational institutions, but an institution which has a huge amount. Should other charities be denied the opportunity to raise money for an endowment because Mr. Borkoff says the charities that have reserves should be downgraded in their grant that they receive? It doesn't make sense. Mr. Borkoff's rating system that then goes after all of these charities that receive failing grants is not only not a grant to by most of the industry. It's not even a grant to by all the other charity grants that reach. And if you try to do a study of this, which has been done by the National Association of Nonprofit Agencies, that study shows that the rating systems are inconsistent. And so who should we follow? If you're the manager of a charity, should you follow GAAP guidelines in doing your accounting? Or should you follow the charity watchdog's rules and make up their own way of looking at things? I would hope that the committee is interested more in public policy and in legislative opportunities than we are in going after Mr. Borkoff's family grade charities. If so, I would be delighted to answer questions about what recommendations we might have for legislation that could be helpful to the charitable community and the donors, and to, as Mr. Isay suggested, members of other charitable communities, including cancer victims and unwed mothers and the homeless and so forth. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Peters. Mr. Jones.
Supervisory and investigative powers over the activities of charitable
The criminal case is filed against an executive director who embezzled funds from a small victim's charity. We face three major challenges. One is our limited ability to address compliance because our registry is stuck with the best. We're in the final phase of our automation project, which, when completed, will allow us to more comprehensively supervise and systematically address compliance. For example, we have over 92,000 registrants. We estimate 50,000 of them are delinquent. Another 90,000 who are incorporated in California are not registered, and we think at least half of them should be. Our second challenge is related to the first. Case selection is primarily complaint-driven. Once we are automated, we will be able to track abuses in a more sophisticated fashion and target specific issues. Our third challenge is to protect charitable assets effectively, given our limited staff and budget resources, a challenge faced by many state charity offices. We encourage compliance by offering guidance on our website and in community outreach. We offer charities the opportunity to take corrective action before we take legal action. We form relationships with other government agencies so that we can triage complaints and refer them to other agencies that may be able to more effectively deal with them. We participate in multi-agency task forces and multi-state litigation in order to extend our enforcement capability, and we publish guidance to assist donors in gathering the information they need to make wise-giving choices. Our ability to address our fundraising costs is limited by the Supreme Court cases that have been discussed. Our response was to amend our Supervision Act to require fundraising professionals to register and file annual reports. We post them on our website. We publish an annual report summarizing the content. We've also added provisions that require specific contract terms and prohibit non-voidable contracts. With regard to addressing fundraising abuse, we're primarily relying on complaints. Regarding the charitable giving, includes a privilege to help donors find relevant information on the 990 and checklist of questions donors can ask and factors they need to consider to assure their contributions are used in the way they intend. Problem areas of solicitation in our experience include telemarketing and direct mail appeal because of misrepresentations. Again, donors are the first level of defense because if they are educated, they can make wise choices and they can refuse to give to organizations that do not fit the profile they've set. We found no mechanism to quantify fraud in this area. Fraudulent schemes will not necessarily come to our attention, and if they do, it is after the fact, and generally after the assets are lost. For these reasons, donors must be vigilant and willing to take the time to assure they know what benefit from their contribution and how it will be used. The bottom line is that, in order to minimize waste and diversion, donors, members of boards of directors, and state charity regulators all have a role in controlling abuses and the solicitation of contributions and the operation of the charities themselves. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Johnson. We'll have a series of questions from members of the committee who are up for 5 minutes each. Let's start off with questions first. Mr. Chapin, you have made the testimony that the state efforts use most of their contributions to provide services to veterans. You say, hospitalized veterans uses 2/3 of its funds to serve veterans. You claim that the color recipient, so that the America's heroes, use more than 90% of it. It's budget to help veterans. It sounds pretty good, but it's not true. It's not accurate. The committee staff examined your group's financial statements. They found that if you remove all the grants from one group to the other, and if you don't catch your mass mailings as a service to veterans, the numbers are actually much, much lower. And that's what we found in the paper chart. In the last 3 years, 2004, 2005, and 2006, your two groups combined received donations of $169 million. And only a quarter of these revenues went to provide actual goods and services for veterans. That means only $1 out of every $4 you received annual directly assisting veterans. That's a very different story than what is in your testimony. And it does match what you told our committee staff when you met with them last week during your interview. Last week, you confirmed that 3/4 of the donations actually do not result in the delivery of goods and services to veterans, and I quote from what you said.
Person, if you're private, Thank you. $15 and take a tax deduction, so it costs them $10.50. Chapin, but they don't have any answer to these sorts of questions. These simple documents that the paper said it's here, they promote support for who has never guessed it when it was supposed to be open. At the same time, I don't think you may have been doing quite well for yourself and your life. You don't have any numbers with your friends. You have provided the committee with a spreadsheet detailing your compensation history, but I'd like to walk you through exactly how much you and your wife have received over the past 3 years from 2004 through 2006. First, both of you made your wife receive salaries. You lost those approximately 200 times.
I'm sorry? I'm saying you're not retired.
When did you retire?
When
did you retire?
Salary of maximum $65,000 at her highest point. She's finally had a buyer.
Okay,
I don't know how many $1 million for her.
I don't believe it.
I'm not 10 times.
But really, I'm convinced this is a great white figure. Great asset for the company. We'll stay and see the answer now. But you and your wife are six hours. You're also supposed to watch me to a $50,000 a year. But for more than the Secretary of Defense, or the Secretary of Veterans Affairs, you both also received bonuses during this year. They varied, but in 2006, you received a $50,000 bonus. How many of you received a $50,000 bonus? Your wife may also receive thousands of dollars in bonuses. Finally,
let me finish up on those things. I'm getting out of the way.
Finally, you have generous pensions. I think you referred to that a moment ago. With your retirement, you'll get 75% of your salary for life. Over $200,000 per year. This costs almost an entire $100,000 a year. So, based on the data you provided to the committee, when you total up all of these salaries, bonuses, and pension contributions in 2004, 2005, and 2006, you and your wife received more than $1.5 million. That's my story. You have been. My question is not a legal one. It's not whether you broke the law, so I don't think you did it. My question is whether you believe this compensation is appropriate for someone who works in a charity for veterans. Because you and your wife got over $1 million during these 3 years. The public thought this money was going to veterans, but instead it went to you and your wife. Over a 3 year period, you raised $168 million from the public, but very little of that went to veterans. You spent almost $124 million over your salaries, minimums, payments, to Mr. Bailey's program. And you and your wife got over $1 million for yourselves. That sounds like a great business for you, Mr. Bailey. But I'm not asking you to look for contributors and veterans. How do you respond to that?
Because it's a performance issue, retirement, like it's a 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 ret firms made at least 25% of all their donations in 2008, because 25% of all the political donations come from the right now at the same expense that we have. And I'm not sure that it first responds to our constituencies. I'm not trying to be a wise apple, but if only 25 cents on the dollar is actually going to get paid, it's just
you know, this morning, it's an excellent question. You know, what I'd like to do is, you know, turn back history 15 years. And if you looked at charity in the United States, there were a lot fewer charities. And it reminds me of the license we talked to those colleagues about Americans professionally to get together in clubs and groups and the huge diversity of interests that they have. But back then, there were a lot fewer charities. What's happened in our country is the democratization of fundraising. And direct response, not just mail, but other forms of direct response fundraising, have allowed us to reach into communities that previously were never asked to support nonprofits. It's allowed us to get into those communities and allow people to express their feelings, who they support, and how they support them. And yet, we, through regulation and through IRS rules and through transparency, we allow the donor to see whatever they wish to see. Every charity has a website, the guidelines are available. Everyone can go to GuideStar and look up the ratios if they wish to do so. But without that, we would be back to the days of rich people letting a few crumbs drop off the table for poor people.
I think it's fair to say, I think. Disabled parents without legs. We've got a young child, as a matter of fact, and his wife was living in the back of his car and is freezing because this guy doesn't have any other means. As a matter of fact, he was evicted from his trailer. And what happened?
That's the answer. I think that didn't happen to service it. The opportunity to answer the question, sir.
Send a full answer to the question.
I was watching.
Looking very carefully at the facts that are presented to us, and you are here to help clarify if we have the right information. And I do appreciate you coming. As you know, we sought your input before, and you are not here. So this gives you an opportunity to speak directly to us with the facts. So I want to call you about a letter that was sent to you on December 22nd of 2006 from a Dorothy W. Smith, Houston, Texas. And she says, dear sir, I have contributed to your organization in previous years and may end in the process of evaluating my contributions for 2007. I would appreciate knowing the percentage in charities received versus administrative costs and other expenditures. And she goes on, your response are Alicia Griffin responding
position to see American schools. Please note that 92 cents of every $1 donated goes towards programs supported by the coalition to saving America's heroes, and then the programs that use emergency financial aid, etc. Can you then clarify for us? You said that 100%, 92% of what is donated goes out for charitable causes. Can you clarify that for us?
It's not restricted specifically in terms of the coalition is supposed to not possible money for us. You're talking about a particular year.
Your response was said, well, the response was March 14, 2010.
Yeah. Our customized ads were not directly sought fit to make a substantial amount of money to try to convert it to a brand. And they were also by $2.5 million to the coalition. And so, therefore, the coalition did have an extraordinary amount of financial costs. And it started in 2007. The coalition did its own direct mail as opposed to a change in the direct mail and passing on the money to the coalition. And that was a reason why we did have very low financial costs. To start the coalition, if I may just mention it, I have to borrow $500,000. The amount of money was represented back to the additional $260,000, which I advanced the coalition in its best way. But any of the various expenses that I was incurring on my first 3 years, total $760,000, which represented over half of my after tax compensation for the previous 10 years, because I believed in what I was doing. The fact of the matter is, just so that's the idea of my commitment to this, when I started the coalition, the first thing we did was direct mail, we got this from there, and so in general, and we borrowed the same kind of
agreement. I can't say, I believe it's true, but as you know, my partner, one of our assets, was
the mail in for a lot of corporations. I went for, I just assumed that corporations would even look like they're talking for their markets. And then that, in the meantime, the employee is wonderful around the recovery conference. Which everybody knew on the NBA participated in this, and we're helping watch these guys on the road to recovery. We pay over $1,200 a man, most severely disabled veterans and their families. And by that time, we have committed to well over 100 of these veterans and their families to come to the recovery conference in December of 2004. I was faced with a very, very tough personal decision.
Let me just ask you this.
I started to say, well, I don't know what I'm saying. My client has said, well, I just don't want to check it out. Well, to ask the questions you want. But when you can give me another minute, I understand your time and your all of this stuff. But there's some very specific things I'd like you to address, please. And I'd like to start to put up on the screen. There was an issue dealing with the country club in Temecula. California, it's called the Cross Creek Golf Club. Are you familiar with it?
Yeah.
According to the resolution from HHV Board in 2001 that's been provided to this committee, HHV authorized the payment of $17,000 a year for corporate membership to the country club in the name of Mark Lynch, the executive director. Can you help clarify and explain to us why your group is spending money donated to your veterans on a country club membership?
I think it was entirely appropriate at the board that plays golf when they come to meetings out there with boards on volunteers. They don't come to meetings. Okay, I just assume they don't get paid to come to meetings. And that's what you might call
board on July 28, 2003. These minutes state that the board authorized a loan of $135,000 to this village. According to the minutes, the purpose of this loan was to provide Rich the ability to purchase his ex-spouse's interest in his home. Now, to me, this looks like a personal loan to this village, not a business expense. And so, Mr. Chapin, can you clarify that for me?
Mr. Chapin, I'm sorry, Mr. Chapin, I'm not Mr. Chapin.
Okay, I really appreciate the chair allowing. Tom, I just want to say this. It seems to me that a personal loan of $135,000 at a time when we have veterans that are not receiving the care immediately, regardless of whether he paid it back or not, appears inappropriate. And this is something that I would like our Attorney General to take a look at.
From going to a paper system going to electronic. Do you feel that that will give your agency the ability to monitor nonprofit activities and keep a closer watch on what's been going on in the country? The other issue that I raised was the fact that the front line of what's the state right was effective. Charitable is the donor themselves. Now, I've run into situations where I've seen fundraisers going to my mother try to scare the heck out of them. But the fact that they give us money now, they're going to get the Social Security, they're going to get the Medicare, and all that stuff. But there's no type of electronic media where you're going to be able to monitor those kind of fundraising activities, especially the scare tactics for seniors.
No, because unless somebody sends us those mailings, we all know that they're occurring. We require fundraisers to get notice before they start a campaign in California, but they don't have to send us the mailings.
Do you have any way of developing a policy of proactive contact with donors to make sure that they know that if they have any questions or have the ability to? Because I think it's pretty well public record that, especially with the senior population, that there are certain individuals, not necessarily very wealthy, who really are on the backbone of the charitable, like male contributions. You put in a proactive contact with them saying, if you have any questions, if you have any concerns, contact us rather than waiting for them to just come up. So I guess I'm asking you, are you going to do direct mailing yourself?
Well, we have no way of knowing who donors are. What we do is post a lot of information on our website for donors. We invite them to call us and send us emails, and we can give them guidance where to go and tips about how to assess charities. Several years ago, I did a series of presentations to senior communities, and I'm about to do that again to help communities at large understand what they can do to make wise decisions.
Mr. Peters, Josh has no ability of knowing what the list are that nonprofits are receiving contributions for. Those can be made available for. Are those all protected under privacy?
No, in fact, when I teach, when I ask a group of this Jones group of sharing regulation officials, that's all exactly how they do it. That is, we have a very modest budget of a couple hundred dollars, and make a $10 contribution to the charities. And
Thank you.
what they do is great competition.
Okay, so it's not very important to use constructs. We are thinking that we employ
started for the lab is on the fact is we don't know the transmission data. But
systems for Mr. Chapin's care, but charities are inconsistent, and in some cases, some of the ratings people rate the same. I believe one of the members ran a list, like Mr. Gordon, they ran a list of almost 30 or 40 charities that have the same rating. That kind of inconsistency is very typical. Mr. Chapin can talk about the ratings, what charities, the people of charities, and how your salary compares to the salary. Associated himself with our organization, Mr. Chapin. As I understand it, he has not been removed from all of the information that's provided by our organization.
That's great.
Okay. Now, I want to recognize
I'm Thank you.
according to these commitments, rather than applications that struck out with the military and started some previous years with your bank work. This is a general carry, which is on fire's work, when the first round for the coalition struck out.
Thank you.
that if you were starting from scratch and doing an RFP and having people come in and make the case, what are the kinds of things you would look at and compare it and contrast on how efficient the standards are in deciding whether to hire?
Well, it's always a tough decision to make on the basis of the track record. One of your charities is known for what kind of success is this. It's very difficult sometimes to determine that because most of these numbers are pretty confidential. I will say that as far as Richard is concerned, we do have an arm's length relationship. As a matter of fact, we didn't want to know more about it. We thought it was appropriate. We don't want to do more for the coalition. So I said to Richard, I'll tell you what typically is 10 cents on it. You lose 10 cents on the prospect metric. I said to Richard, look, you ought to do what you find more than what I think is appropriate. Then we're going to limit it. We're going to put a governor on it. 5 cent marks and you have to pay for. Now, I did a payment. It's interesting you mentioned what. Why did you think you wanted to do more? Why did you think what you wanted to do was your program?
Well, Richard gets paid. I'm not paid on performance basis. Richard gets paid 6-7 cents per minute for the most part.
Now, so what is it? Center for British wanted you to maximize the value. We have a governor, used to be Richard's account executive, who now works for us, so he puts a governor on Richard. So I said to Richard, look, I'll pay you a premium and a penny a pound, but you have to absorb any loss over 5 cents, because typically we lose 10 cents. So Richard plays by the way his mouth was, and he said, fine, well, conservation work was $500,000.
Well, you introduced in the conversation, this is kind of where I was at. The maximum capacity of your scrutiny of the returns of these contracts between the charities and the mail houses. That's to make sure they're efficient, that's to make sure that there's no incentive to just send mail out willy-nilly because you're going to get a return on each piece, which brings me to the last sort of point of question I wanted to put to. I'm very focused on the kind of disclosure there can be. You've suggested that it's so hard to compare and contrast the different criteria for determining whether a charity is a good one or is it an official or not. But that can't be the end of the conversation. There's got to be a way to provide more information to the donor. Apples to apples, oranges to oranges, so that they can make some judgment of whether this is a charity that's going to name of their donation, they're responsible. Actually, what I keep hearing is this so complicated to do that we have to throw our hands in. And so, help me with that, because we need to think about the work.
Yeah, let me narrow your perception of what I said. I was focused on the measure cost of fundraising ratio as being how it's going to turn out by everybody that's looked at in a responsible way. That does not for a moment mean that charities should not be transparent, that they should not be required to reveal whatever information the donor wishes to receive. And in fact, under IRS guidelines, charities are required to post and give to everyone who wishes a copy all of their financial statements and their I-90 and their K-23, which is the original application for exemption. So I do not for a moment want you to understand me to be saying that we are opposed to the charitable community as opposed to disclosure. We are in favor of transparency. We are in favor of disclosure. We are in favor of informed donors. But we are not in favor is a regime, either by the government or by misguided private bus drivers, that rely exclusively on a measure that we know to be unreliable and use a one-size-fits-all measure for the ranking of charities. And that's all I was trying to say. That was time has expired. I just want to make a comment. Mr. Chairman, you're my witness. You talked about getting on Friday to just do all this. Some people say there are too many names, but the truth of the matter is,
think your house is safe more than a lot. Go to a friend's going to have $1,000. Say that they won't be part of it anymore. They don't deal that money. Others got money. You got your plate. Mr. Victor, we got this plate. Everybody got a plate. But what was it? The was only 25 cents for the balance. Now, I know you said this is the way it is. I don't think that's the way it should be. I don't think that's right. Because I look at how you're paid for this whole operation. You are doing very well for yourself. No one, no family can get the kind of money you're doing. No family can get the kind of money you're doing. No executive, except at the very right time of some major corporations, get the kind of tech you're taking out of this. No one wanted it. If we had something new, we'd turn to the veterans more than just 25 cents on the line. If we can change that, we have less of our problems.
About my targets, because every other CEO, which is over half of them, gave the same kind of compensation that I'm getting more. I'm getting my targets as a YMCA, as a Boy Scouts, and
there are other veterans groups that raise money, that provide services to veterans, that don't have nearly the overhead costs that you have. It isn't true that every charity has the same overhead costs that you've claimed. A lot of them have held down their costs so they can do more for the charitable purpose and less for the overhead and the personal purposes that went to
one. Well, I suppose it's the overhead is higher cost than really. They're either the enemy has about the same cost, they're uninvited, the American Legion, and very, very friendly to them, because they've done it with all these folks.
And I don't know if you're sure that everybody does it. That's the thing, is what I'm going to do. It's if everybody does it, because it seems to me that the worship is the kind of thing.
You've got to take a lot of doing it.
Well, I'll tell you what, Chick, the way is the federal government will have to watch my friends' veterans. That's what we should be doing. Yeah. This is my 3 years of life. This has been a fascinating thing. A lot of it is first to get to 50 to 20 cents. And I do want to ask you, Mr. Chapin, am I up to understand that your place in the life veterans, the coalition to shield American girls' foundation, although they basically had 75% cost and 25% benefit to the veteran. Is that accurate? Is that your statement that work on this?
Generally speaking, I understand that it's not really applies to help wounded heroes. That's just not getting off the kind of education that you see on the
side. Yeah, help wounded heroes even has less or more to the veteran's time.
Probably have close to 100%.
100% goes to the veterans. 100% goes to the veterans.
No.
100% goes to
the veterans. To communicate the message to Congress.
To raise money. To raise this in cost or benefit. I just want to know the difference. And I don't want to waste my own time, but Mr. Chairman, I would like to ask permission that I can keep going on until I get answers to my questions. So can I keep going on? So the answer is most of that expense or a benefit to veterans.
It's not a hard question to answer. The help wounded heroes for Congressman is not a charity. We don't profess to give a dime to charity.
Okay, so it's an act of charity, but it's just not going to veterans. It goes to getting the word out.
Precisely, but that's what I'm going to
do. You answer the question for me. Now, I would say to you that I came having stronger feelings about this issue than I do now, but I still believe that 25% to the veterans and 75% cost is too much. And I just want to say that, Mr. Gregory, I consider you to be the beginning and the end as it comes to financing. And you have reason to be proud of how you've done it. Well, I will say to you that what's better is that in the political side of the equation, we have more money to spend, and our opponents have more money to spend. They get more money to spend, we have more money to spend. And that's the reality of the world. But to your credit, I was raised, though, as a young person that when someone is asked a question that goes on to attack, it's usually a defensive method because they don't want to answer your questions. You have valid answers to questions, but you want to attack and basically say, we're going to investigate progress. And it makes me think that you have some things that you don't want discussed
First of all, you said, "Hi, this morning, Charities are standing in the Congress." No, Mr. Sanders, the Congress, the members of Congress are standing in the Congress.
I didn't hear you right. If you're right, John, I understand. I'm not going to disagree with you. But I am not going to disagree that Congress is standing in the Congress. That's true. And each of us is up for re-election, and our constituency has to evaluate. You and I agree. But it's irrelevant right now under this issue. Our charities, and I am going to fact, I will fail because we are not doing a better job of charities. But if you want to be around the Congress, I'm going to forget about it. So be it. You want to feel that you can spend it a day, a week, or whatever. I have a tour that will be co-sponsor of the Congressional Accountability Act that said that if we pass it in 1995, it said whatever laws we pass on Congress, we should pass. On the public, we should pass on Congress, and it passed, it was part of the contract with America. I don't disagree with you that what we impose on others, we should have to buy ourselves. So tell me, in terms of our campaign fundraising, what you think would be helpful, because I also think that I have had some interest in campaign fundraising, but once you get beyond that, then I want to ask you a question about what you do. So tell me, what do you suggest we do in campaign fundraising, because usually, I find people, particularly conservative people, they're opposed to having stronger laws that can't be fundraising.
Well, thank you, Congressman. You're right. It's not going to be a good thing. It's not going to be a good thing.
It's not going to be a good thing. It's not going to be a good thing.
But I have my son, this girl, having a nomination that we have with the former president of Mexico. And this is the kind of program where we have to make a point over and over.
Of something you advocate. Tell me what we require on you that we don't require on us that you think makes sense.
Well, first of all, regarding radios, the background, the contracts that we have when we're paid, Congress doesn't make that contract.
So I think we do support a lot of it, so we should disclose the contract. Thank you. I'm going to ask you this question. Would you be opposed in all your fundraising solicitations to send it to the donor? 25% goes to veterans, 75% goes to